You're one in a million. This is for all the girls. Hey guys, it's been a hot minute since I have done a video on just the basics as far as creating cups goes. So I thought I would do a video to kind of go over the things that I have changed since I started, as well as just kind of the basics of what you need to start. And then I'll go into a few more details on what things you can add to that moving forward and what you can use in order to make cups. So just to go from like the basics of what you're gonna need to make a cup, you're gonna need a cup. So like that's pretty important. You need to have some kind of cup to start with. It can be one of anything really. You don't want a cup that's gonna be bendable. So like if a squeeze bottle or something like that is not gonna work, you can use stainless steel, which there's a ton of tumblers that you can use for that. Acrylic cups, those are okay to use because they're hard plastic, so those are fine to use. Glass, like a stemless wine glass or a regular glass, anything that's glass, mason jars, those kinds of things, those are all fine to use for adding your glitter to. So I do recommend kind of just starting with stainless to kind of give you a base to go from, but I've seen people start with just acrylic or something else that, you know, they got cheap and they just wanted to try it with, and all of that is completely fine. The main thing you don't want to use is anything that epoxy or adhesive wouldn't stick to. So like wax paper, anything that's silicone, anything that's bendable, those are the kinds of things that you don't want to use. The next thing that you're going to need is sandpaper in order to prep your cup the appropriate way, which when I started, I didn't know about prepping, so I didn't do it. That was something that I've learned here in the last year and a half about after doing it, because I've now been working on cups for approximately 3.5 years, almost 4. And I have learned that prepping your cup is very important. So I do recommend that everybody does that. So sandpaper. Another thing that you want to remember when you actually sand your cups is that you should do it wet sanding. That goes for sanding your stainless steel as well as sanding your epoxy. Reason being is the shavings that come off are carcinogenic. So you do not want to sand your stainless steel tumblers just with no ability to get it off of you, because it's not good for you. It's cancer causing. Don't do it. Sand it in the sink or in some area that you have water running that you can continually get it off, and then you want to wash your cup. So cup, sandpaper. The next part is spray paint is something that I've started doing. I didn't do that when I very first started cups either. This is something that I've learned as I've gone along, that if you do spray a base paint coat of paint, it gives your glitter something to kind of back it up, just in case you have a translucent glitter. You don't need to use two coats, because when I did Mod Podge application, I always used two coats of glitter, sometimes three, to get a full coverage and to get all of the cup completely covered. So I've learned if you use a spray paint behind your glitter, it just helps. Now, I typically do try to match my glitter with my spray paint color as close as I can, and that does help to do that. So that's the third thing, if we're keeping track here. The next thing is your adhesive. Now, there are still a lot of people that use Mod Podge as adhesive. I always used Hard Coat Mod Podge. That was the first thing that I used as my adhesive. And I still have instances where I do use Mod Podge, like when I'm using intricate designs and stuff like that. I haven't felt comfortable enough to use epoxy yet to do that, but almost, I would probably say 95% of my cups now, I use epoxy as my adhesive, and I use a very, very thin coat. I do have YouTube videos that show how I do that. So if you're interested in learning that, I do have a prep video that I show how I do it, and I do have a epoxy. I have several epoxy application methods that I've done, but it's a very, very thin coat. It's not like a seal coat of epoxy, where you are using a thicker coat, it's just very thin. Like, you want to just basically apply the epoxy on there and then just take everything off, except just a very, very thin coat to apply your glitter. If you get too much epoxy on there, it will soak up your glitter as you apply it, and it just won't look right. So you want to get a very, very thin coat and then apply it, apply your glitter, and keep applying it until it's completely covered and nothing is shiny. So adhesive, that's the next thing that I was talking about. Then the next part is glitter, and I'm just talking about like a basic cup. I'm not going to go into details for all the different techniques that you can do, but this is just a basic cup, the basic supplies, because I get asked this a lot, and so I figured it might just be beneficial to have a video to show you guys what the basics are. So glitter. Now keep in mind that fine glitters are a lot easier to use than a chunky glitter. People have a ton of issues with chunky glitters. If you're going to use chunky glitters, I do recommend either using a little bit more epoxy so it can kind of soak it up so that the glitter will lay a little bit flatter, or just focus on using fine glitter until you get that tuned, you know, fine-tuned in how to do that, because it is a little bit harder. I do have videos on ways to use the chunkies. You can apply it second, like as a secondary type thing, where you apply all fine first and then you add the chunky onto your epoxy coat. I also have a video where I actually put the chunky into my epoxy and then apply it all at once onto an already pre-based cup, and that is a fairly easy way to apply it as well, so that it does lay flat because it's inside the epoxy and it goes smooth, and you want to do that on a rotisserie. So there's just a couple things. The next thing is sealer. If you are going to do an intricate design or anything like that, some people actually do use a sealer even on just a one color. I don't. I brush off any of my excess glitter, and then I haven't needed to use a sealer. Even on ombres, I don't use a sealer because I apply it on one color, I apply it on the other color, and then I just kind of mix it in between. So it never really shifts or moves, and I use epoxy that's a little bit thicker, and so it's not gonna shift a whole lot and move the glitter around. And I've already brushed it off completely, so there's really not any glitter to move around. So, but you do need sealer if you're gonna have intricate designs, or like when I did my checkered, obviously you need a sealer on that because you don't want it to move. But any designs that are a little bit more detailed, that you don't want anything to move. So a sealer is the next thing. Then your, I guess one of your final things that you'll need is epoxy. So there are other things I'll talk about at the end of this video, but epoxy is going to give your cup the glass finish that you want. Now, I know a lot of people are like, oh my gosh, I applied epoxy, this does not look good. It's still, I can still feel the glitter through it. So if that happens, which it will, you basically just have too thin of a coat of epoxy, or you just need to have multiple coats of epoxy. I can usually get away because I use enough epoxy on my first coat on my glitter. I can get away with doing one coat and then decaling the majority of the time. If it's a glitter that I know I can't sand down at all, or it's going to either change color or it's going to change the look of it, then I do go ahead and add another coat of it. But I use enough epoxy, which I generally mix up probably 30 mils of epoxy, 15 milliliters each part for my first coats. I like to have a thicker coat just because I don't have to do as many. So epoxy. Now, I'm currently using Counterculture DIY's Artist Resin, which it's been the best that I have used so far. I've used probably 7 different epoxies, and it's been the one that I use that I've liked the best. So I do recommend that. It's a very, very nice epoxy, but outside of that, they have the best customer service hands down that I've ever experienced. They're very personable and they're very helpful with everything so far that I've experienced. They want you to succeed in what you're doing, and so I do very much recommend them. Outside of that, you're going to need either a manual turner or a rotisserie to turn your cups, because if you just put the epoxy on, it's going to drip. You don't want that to happen. It's just going to drip off and you're going to have, it doesn't work because it'll harden with just a big bunch of big drips on there. So you do need a way to turn it. And I do have videos up of manual turners as well as the rotisseries that I've made myself. Etsy has great shops. There's some great shops on Etsy as well as just people that run their own shops that have turners. I have, I think, 3 of the Glamour Tribe Customs turners, and another one of my friends makes great turners, and it's The Cup Turner, all one word. And she's on Etsy and she has great ones. I don't have one myself, but many of my friends have them, so they've very much recommended her. I think there's like Cupasaurus and Absolute Programming. Those are ones that I've heard good things about. The Kraken, I think there's a Kraken, I can't remember the name of it, but they have the Kraken Mini, and there's a couple other ones that they have, and those are good ones. So lots of options out there. I do suggest you do your research, because not all of them are treated the same and you're going to get not good results with some of them. So those are just the basics of what you need. Okay, so now the next big thing that I would like to talk about is protection. Something that I didn't know about when I first started this. I've learned over time that it's something that's very important when you're working with epoxy, is PPE, which is personal protection equipment. And it's something that everybody should be using when you're working with epoxy. So I very much suggest to do your research. I'm not going to tell you what to do. I'm not going to tell you what's safe, because I am not a chemist. I don't claim to know anything about that. I've done my research. I'm doing what I feel comfortable doing, and I very much suggest that you do the same. But things that are very important is having a respirator. Most of the epoxies are gonna say that they're like VOC, which is fine, but even VOC free stuff can have some adverse side effects. You can have an exposure type of a reaction, which means that you've just built up over time enough chemical in your system that you can react to it. Some people have allergic reactions, so I very much recommend that you look into getting respirator, using gloves, using, you know, full gear if you feel the need to do that as well. Having ventilation in your home space that you're doing it, or an outside space, however you know, see fit in order of doing that. So just that's something that I will recommend that you look into yourself and do what's comfortable for you and what works for you. Other things that you're going to need just that go along with creating cups. For measuring your epoxy, you will need some kind of a measuring cup. If you read the directions, which I recommend you read the directions for how to mix your epoxy, most of them are by volume. So that means don't weigh your cups. And I would even recommend, I know some people do it, I don't recommend it. Some people will weigh them on a scale from pouring in the volume, and then they use those measurements to do it the next time. I don't recommend it, because when it says measure by volume each time, I'm gonna measure by volume, because the weight can fluctuate, so it's not gonna be the same. So I don't recommend that. So cups, and then sticks. I actually switched over to, if I can get it out of here, this swizzle stick. It's a metal stick, so it doesn't have any issues. I used to use popsicle sticks, but I did notice that the popsicle sticks were a little bit more bubbly when I switched over to the swizzle stick. It decreased my bubble once I got done stirring it by quite a bit. So I do recommend using the metal stick if you are able to. I have also a link on Amazon that is like a craft list, and I will post it in this video, but I kind of keep everything on this list that I recommend if it's on Amazon. So you can go there and just kind of check out the things that I've added to my list. So cups for measuring the swizzle stick. I do recommend switching cups. So mixing in one. If you see my epoxy video, I mix in one. I switch, I wipe off my swizzle stick completely clean with alcohol, and then I mix again. Don't scrape the sides when you pour, just the whole thing. So after that, the next thing that I recommend having is paper or silicone or something to put underneath your cups when you're epoxying them. Wax paper, I use Handy Wax underneath my cups when I'm glittering them. I glitter all of my cups just by hand sitting here, and I don't put them, like, they don't need to rotate if you're just using a very, very thin coat of epoxy. They don't need to rotate. So you can just put them up on a stand. Like, for instance, when I got done doing this one, I literally just stuck it in a little stand that I have over here, because once it's done being glittered, it's not gonna move. You're using such a small amount of epoxy that it's not gonna move, it's not gonna shift. So keep your epoxy very, very thin coat and you won't have that problem. Tape. Some people tape their cups, some people don't. This is complete preference. I provide straws with all of my cups, so they don't have to put their mouth on it if they're not comfortable doing that. Epoxy is an inert plastic once it's cured, and so incidental contact is okay. So there are a lot of people that do drink directly from it. I don't feel comfortable doing it with myself, so I wouldn't want somebody else to do that, so I always provide straws. That's just my preference. There's no right or wrong way, really, I don't think, but I feel more comfortable using a straw or using, you know, the cup that has a little bit higher lip. So that's what I do. But taping off, so you would need tape, and I use electrical tape. I've used a few different kinds of tape. Hockey puck tape, I tried as like one of the first things I did, and it was kind of hard, and it was way more expensive than you just buying like a big old stack of electrical tape at like Arbor Freight. Or Amazon has it for fairly cheap too. So those are the kinds of things that I have. I also use, let's see where my other piece is. I use a hair tie, and I also use this, just, it's called elastic, I think it's called elastic cord or elastic something, but I just glued the ends of it together and measured it, so I can use these two for when I'm measuring my cups. And then I have just a little line on how far I go up on my cups when I'm taping them off, and then I wrap the tape around and use those as a guide as wrapping, and I have that on one of my videos on my channel here. So those are also good things to know. The next huge thing, which, if you're going to be doing this and customizing cups for people, then I do suggest getting a cutting machine. You can get, I think, I mean, there's a couple brands, but Silhouette and Cricut, those are the two main ones. I have a Silhouette Cameo, and it's a two. I have the second version, and you just, I mean, if you're gonna customize anything, you might as well get them. It's better to have your own than to have to purchase them from somebody else. It is a fairly big expense, so not everybody will want to do it, but I do recommend it if you're going to be doing it. Now, going along with getting a cutting machine, you're going to have to purchase vinyl, and you're going to have to purchase transfer tape, because once you cut it and weed it, You're going to need to use the transfer tape, and I use Transfer Right, and I've also tried TechCraft. I think it's called TechCraft. I just bought some from them to try theirs as well, but you have to use transfer tape in order to stick it, pull up your vinyl, and then place it onto your cup. So those are all things that you would need. The next thing that you'll most likely need is acetone alcohol, 99%, I think is what I usually use. 90 or 99% is what I use. And baby wipes, those are things that you wanna have on hand. Now, if you get epoxy on your hands, don't use acetone or alcohol because those are solvents and they will dissolve that epoxy on your hand and it'll actually seep into your skin faster that way. I just keep a thing of baby wipes and I wipe off anything that I get on my hands, and that's going to be the best. You want something that's cleansing of that, but not solvent, like that's going to eat away at the actual epoxy because it'll disperse it into your skin that way. So just a couple tips on that. Okay, so the next part is your business and your branding. If you're going to be doing this and you want to have a good presentation, things that you will want to think about is, do you want to have business cards? Do you want to have labels for your cups? Labels on the bottom of cups can be very controversial, and I suggest doing whatever you feel comfortable with and what you want to do. Your customers will either tell you they don't want it. I have never had anybody actually tell me they didn't want it. I've had a couple people I know who don't, and so I don't do it. But I always put a label, and I have purchased from Sticker Mule, and there, I do have a referral link, so I'll include that in my video here. But I use Sticker Mule because they have options. You can use stickers, which are permanent, or you can use labels, which are semi-permanent. They do come off. So I always just use the labels on the bottom of my cups, and I put them on the outside of epoxy if I'm actually going to cover the whole cup. So if it's a full coverage cup, I use it on the outside. And the reason I do that is because if they don't like it, they can remove it. It's as simple as that. Care cards. You always want to make sure you're telling your customers. I include it on my invoice on how they should care for their cup. But I have created these magnets with Sticker Mule, and they go over my care instructions. So they can just pop this on their fridge and they will have it and they will know how to care for their cups. And those are from Sticker Mule. They have really good, I was able just to design it and upload it, and it's great. So that is branding. I also have shipping tape. I've done a few different kinds. This one, which it's backwards, I'm sorry, but it might not be, I don't know. But it says Mineral Creations and Just Spread the Sparkle. And this goes on my actual packages when I deliver them. I'm kind of extra. I like to make it look like a gift when they're receiving it. So I kind of go a little bit over the top with everything, but I've really gotten good response from people when they've received it. So I've kind of done it since the very first one that I shipped. I wanted it to be pretty. I wanted it to seem like a gift. And so I make all of my packaging and business branding to be that kind of way. And this is what I use for my stickers. So another thing I get asked is, what alternatives are there to epoxy? So I just wanted to touch on this a little bit. There is 2K, and there's another one called Diamond Sealer or something like that. Just as a forewarning, 2K needs a lot of setup, and it needs just as much ventilation and everything when you're applying it as the epoxy. So just take that for what it's worth. But I hope this was helpful and gives you an idea of what you need in order to create your cups. And I hope you guys all have a great day. Thank you. I'm sorry for all of the ums, guys. Thanks for watching. Like and subscribe if you'd like to see more. Drop me a comment if you have any questions.